out of Kadash from One Nation, One Power. Shalom.
Shalom, Israel. This is Chaya Banya Sharala from One Nation, One Power. Shalom.
Shalom, brother Guy Kwa from One Nation, One Power. All praise and glory to the Most High, Ahaya, Bashim and Shia, coming to this truth, bringing this truth on to my brothers and sisters out there, for all 12 tribes.
Shalom, this is Eldad Yo from One Nation, One Power, a demon stomper. Want to just say shalom.
Elder Kakal Acham, praise the Most High.
Love me like you. So I just wanna love you the way you love me, Lord. I just wanna love you the way you love me, Lord. I just wanna love you the way you love
me. Shalom, brothers and sisters. This is Elder Kadash from One Nation, One Power. And I wanna give all glory, honor, and praise where praise is due. To the Most High God, Ahaya, in the mighty name of Yeshaya, and the Ruach Kodesh, which is the Holy Spirit. And I'm coming to you once again with another breakdown, another message, another little lesson. You're going to need your seal book of more, okay? You're going to need the book of more, and you're going to need your Bible. All right, we're going to go on a little ride, and my outer likes to stay. We're going to go straight into it. If you want to know how to break down the Bible, here are the scriptures for it. It's Isaiah chapter 28, verse 9 and 10. That's how you break down the Bible. Another precept is 2 Nephi, chapter 28, verse 30 and 31. And another precept is Psalms 119 and 104. Through thy precepts I get understanding. Therefore, I hate every false way. All right, brothers and sisters, we're going to get straight into it. I want you guys to go to your sealed book of Mormon. And we're going to go to page 150, okay? As the Holy Spirit moves me to break down these chapters, okay? We're going to go with the precepts, okay? And this is chapter 6 of the three Nephites, okay? And there's some firepower in this chapter. And I want to get straight into it. First and foremost, you know, I want to say that we are looking to be a royal priesthood, okay, under the order of Melchizedek. And we got to learn how to operate in this order and how the devil attacks us in this order, okay? And this chapter brings it forth, all right? So now, let's go straight into it. This is the Seal Book of Mormon. We're in the Three Nephites, chapter 6. All right? And it reads, this is verse 1. And it reads, this is how Yeshaya, or Jesus, told us while he was among us. Okay, so Yeshaya is telling them specific instructions while he was with the 12 disciples in this land. Okay, if you obey my commands strictly and keep my covenants, then you will be my special property among all the people of the earth. Okay, so he's saying, you know, if you do my commandments and keep them, you're gonna be a special property. I'm gonna stamp you guys above all other people. Okay, let's keep reading. And you yourselves will become a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. Say what? And you yourself will become a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. This is what we want. This is what we're doing. right now at this time. We want to be a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. Okay, let's get the precepts to back this up. Okay, because we don't just want to just have one. We want to have two or three, right? So now, those of you that are new, that don't know these scriptures, let's go to Exodus. Exodus 19 and 6. Exodus 19 and 6. Because this is what he's calling us to. Exodus 19 and 6. I'm going to go to the first stick. And this is Exodus chapter 19 and verse 6. And ye shall be unto me a kingdom of priests. A what? A kingdom of priests. And a holy nation. And a what? And a holy nation. These are the words which thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel. Unto the who? Unto the children of Israel. So back here in Exodus, the Most High wanted to establish this with us at that time. Okay? But what happened? We broke the covenant. Okay? We sinned under the priesthood of Aaron. All right? Let's get one more precept. Let's go to 1 Peter. 1 Peter. 1 Peter 2 and 9. 1 Peter 2 and 9. 1 Peter 2 and 9. Let's confirm this. But ye are a chosen generation. You see? And that's what's going on right now. We're being chosen as this generation. That's going on right now. A royal priesthood. A what? A royal priesthood. That's the order of Melchizedek. And holy nation, a particular people, that ye shall show forth the praises of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. All right? So that's your third precept, okay? So now, let's go back to the sealed book of Mormon. So this is what Yeshua is establishing during that time. But now, he's still establishing during this time. Okay? So now let's keep going. This is verse 2. As part of his covenant with Abraham, that all the nations of the earth shall be blessed by means of a chosen seed. Let's keep reading. He, Yeshua, being the promised descendant. Who? He, Yeshua, being the promised descendant, kept this same promise among the children of Lehi. All right? Placing upon me, Nehi, the presidency of the high priesthood of the church. So when Yeshua came to the Nephites, he picked Nephi to be the presidency, being, you know, the chief, okay, of the high priesthood. All right, but why was he chosen? Okay, let's get a precept in the book of Mor. All right, let's go to Alma. Let's go to Alma 13. Alma 13. Because it's the same reason why Shem was picked. Alma 13 and verse 18. Alma 13 and verse 18. And it reads, but Melchizedek, having exercised mighty faith, he did what? He exercised mighty faith and received the office of the high priesthood according to the holy order of God, according to the holy order of God. He just didn't have knowledge, but he had exceedingly great faith. Okay, when you think about faith, you got to go to Hebrews chapter 11, I believe. All right, and read that whole chapter. Okay, let's keep going. It says, He said he received the holy order of God, which was the Son of God, okay, all the way in the beginning, before Aaron. And it says, did preach repentance. He did what? He preached repentance. Okay, so Nephi had to do the same thing unto his people. And behold, they did repent, showed his fruit by repenting. And Melchizedek did establish peace in the land in his days. Therefore, he was called the Prince of Peace. Okay, by him baptizing during Shem's time, there became peace. Okay, that's why he got his name. Let's keep going. For he was the king of Salem, and he did reign under his father. Okay, so I wanted to show you guys that, why Nephi was picked, because he had faith. Okay, just like Abraham when he had to go sacrifice his son, okay, Isaac, he had to show that faith in the Most High. Okay, but we all know what happened. He was saved. All right, let's keep going. And to my descendants after me, from generation to generation. You see that? This is Nephi's descendants. So this order was going to be passed down from generation to generation. And it says, as regards that of his administration here in the land of our inheritance. In where? In the land of our inheritance. In America. All right? Let's keep reading. In parallel with the administration of the Church of Christ in the land of Jerusalem. So it's going to be the same way, just like how the 12 that were operating in the land of Jerusalem, Peter, you know, John, the same things will be established in the land of promise, okay, in America. It says, in parallel with the administration of the Church of Christ in the land of Jerusalem, for how much I, talking about Nephi, had my descendants, according to the diligence that we showed for the gospel of Christ. Listen to this part, okay? Will be the channels of revelation for the church in this land of promise. I'm gonna read that one more time, okay? And it says, for how much I, talking about Nephi, and my descendants, everybody after him, according to the diligence that we showed for the gospel of Christ. So according to their diligence, okay, as they operated in the gospel of Christ, okay, that you had to operate in it, will be the channels, or you can use the word instruments, okay, will be the instruments or channels of revelation. Of what? Of revelation. This is where you get your downloads at, according to your diligence to the gospel of Christ, preaching repentance, baptizing, okay, doing all the things under the order of Melchizedek. Let's keep going. And will be the channels of revelation for the church in this land of promise. In what? In this land of promise. In this land of promise. So it's the same way in nowadays. Okay? We must obey the gospel of Christ. See, and this is why in this ministry, okay, the ones that are following the order of Melchizedek are getting downloads, okay, from the Most High, revelation. We like to use the word downloads. Let's keep reading. Since we have no contact with him who holds the kings of the kingdom. Okay, this is Nephi talking about Peter. They didn't have no contact with him. They couldn't just talk to him on the phone, right? It says, late upon this head, laid upon his head by the hand of Yeshayah, Christ, when he ministered among the Jews in the land of our ancestors, talking about Jerusalem, okay? The basis of his promise, okay, that's what Yeshayah laid on his hand, the basis of his promise, talking about Peter, that extended over the firstborn of his, of this seed. It is superimposed upon the head of a righteous descendant from the line of Nehi. Okay, talking about the presidency that was on Nehi, or the holy priesthood. It's supposed to be passed upon a righteous descendant. That's why I know it, you know what I'm saying? You could receive it, but you got to be righteous. You got to be walking righteous. It says, if the firstborn has not the desire to fill this office in the place of his father, or is not worthy of such. So now it's going to go to your firstborn child. Okay. This priesthood is going to go to your firstborn child, a male, of course. And if they don't want to, you know, walk with it, right? This is what it's saying. Verse 4, being that I, Nehi, myself, with whom Christ made this covenant, I tell you with all the strength of my heart, that we, the Nephites, can become, yea, this special property for Jesus Christ among all our people, from the earth, and become a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. Okay, so this is what was in Nephi's heart. To be, you know, this holy people, to be this priesthood, just like in the days of Enoch, okay, how they were caught up, okay, the new Zion, okay, when you read in the previous chapters before this one, it talks about Enoch in Enoch's time, okay, that they became the same way. This is what Nephi wants to do with his descendants. Okay, let's get a precept real quick. How do we become this holy people? Let's get it real quick. How do we become this holy people? Let's go to Alma 13, and we're gonna read verse 28. Let's start at verse 28. Actually, let's start at verse 26. And it shall be made known unto just and holy men. And it shall be made known to just and holy men by the mouth of angels at the time of his coming, that the words of our fathers may be fulfilled according to that which they have spoken concerning him, which was according to the spirit of prophecy, which was in them. Okay, I'm gonna jump down to verse 28. But that ye would humble yourselves before the Lord. This is how we become that holy nation. And call on his holy name, and watch and pray continually. And do what? Watch and pray continually. No debate. No argue back and forth. We must pray and watch continually and humble ourselves, brothers and sisters. Let's keep going. That ye may not be tempted. That what? That ye may not be tempted by any foolish argument or anything that may be going on in your life. You got to continue to pray and become this holy people. Okay? Watch and pray. All right? You don't want to be tempted in this last hour. And it says, tempted above that which ye can bear, and thus be led by the Holy Spirit, and thus be led by the Holy Spirit, becoming humble. Doing what? Becoming humble. This is where you want to be at this time and hour, becoming humble. Stop worrying about everybody else. Just work on yourself right now. Work on this holy priesthood. Work on becoming, you know, according to this holy priesthood. It says, becoming humble, meek, submissive, all right? Patient, full of love. Full of what? Full of love and long and all long suffering. Verse 29, having faith on the Lord, having in a hope that ye shall receive eternal life, having the love of God always in your hearts, that ye may be lifted up at the last day and enter into his rest. This is where you want to be, brothers and sisters. Stop all the foolishness. Concentrate. Watch and pray. Go to work. Come home. Read your word. Pray. Wake up. Pray. Read your word. Stay connected with God. Don't entertain no other desire. Go to work. Come home. Do it all over again. When you read the book, when you read about Enoch's life in his last days, he wasn't talking to nobody. He was trying to run away from everybody. He was trying to stay connected to God. He stopped teaching. He said, you know what? I'm just going to stay home, pray, and go to work and come home. And that's all I'm going to do. I'm done. I know the devil's tricks, brothers and sisters. Let's keep going. I forgot where I was. Okay, verse 5. Know therefore, all of you, O people of the Church of Christ. Of who? Of the Church of Christ. I'm talking to you, brothers and sisters out there. That Melchizedek was king and priest at the same time. That was Shem. With office to the high priesthood equal to Enoch. To who? To Enoch. I was just talking about him. And now we have this same designation left over Nehi's head. Okay, what happened to Enoch, Shem, now Nehi, and now us, brothers and sisters. We're doing the same thing. And extended to every Nephite nation with the opportunity to produce a kingdom of priests, and thus to promote a royal priesthood among the people of the earth. Verse 6. But this condition depends on strictly observing the commandments of Christ. On what? Strictly observing the commandments of Christ, and indeed keeping his covenant. Let's go over what the commandments of Christ are, brothers and sisters. Because we know, because a lot of brothers, they mess up on this. Okay, and the elder brought it out a couple days ago. But I'm going to show you what we're supposed to observe according to what Christ told us. Let's go to Hebrews 6. Hebrews 6. We know about the laws and the statutes. We know about that. But I'm gonna bring this forth there. Because people leave this out right here. Because this was already established in the very beginning. Before the law was given to us on Mount Zion. All right? Let's go to Hebrews chapter 6. This is what we're supposed to follow. The doctrine of Christ. This is Hebrews chapter 6. We're going to read 1 and 2. Therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, let us go unto perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith towards God. Verse 2, of the doctrine of baptism. This is what we're supposed to do. Strictly observe the commandments of Christ. Okay, read that again. Of the doctrine of baptism. We're supposed to be baptizing, brothers and sisters. Any group out there, they are not baptizing. They ain't strictly observing the commandments of Christ. Let's keep going. And of laying on of hands. Your brothers out there ain't praying over you, and they got the anointing of God on their life, walk away. Let's keep going. And of the resurrection of the dead, talking about the resurrection of the dead, talking about how Yeshua will raise us up in the last days, and of the eternal judgment, talking about hell, where you can end up in the last, before when you leave this earth. This is what you're supposed to follow according to the commandments of Christ, his doctrine. Okay, I know he came in his Father's name, but he also established this in the very beginning. This is what he's talking about when he says, I come in my Father's name. We know that Adam was baptizing. We know that Enoch was baptizing. They all were under this order. All right, brothers and sisters. So if anybody out there is not doing Hebrews chapter 6, verse 1 and 2, walk away. Let's keep going. Verse 7. Nevertheless, let us definitely understand that the law of Moses, okay, the law of Moses, what I was just saying, we know the Ten Commandments, right, which was brought by our ancestors to this land of promise, right, has served as a tutor until Christ appears among us and given us a new covenant. You see that? It was our tutor. Okay, let's get some precepts on that. The law of Moses was our tutor. Okay, just like when we first came into this truth, we just learned strictly the laws of Moses. But now the Most High is lifting us up and taking us back to the beginning, showing us the different levels of Christ. Moses was our tutor, right? Let's get a precept. Let's confirm this. Let's go to Galatians 3 and 24. Galatians 3 and 24. Galatians 3 and 24. See, we haven't forgot about the first stick. We stay in all of them, brothers and sisters. We stay in all of them. This is Galatians. If I could find it. Galatians. Galatians. Galatians 3:24. All right. And it reads, wherefore the law was our schoolmaster, was our tutor. Just like it says right here, our schoolmaster. In the Bible, to bring us unto Christ. To what? To bring us unto Christ, the holy priesthood, that we might be justified by faith. That what? That we might be justified by faith. Because you need faith to be under the holy priesthood of the Son of God. If you don't have faith, you're going to be established under the lesser priesthood, which is under Aaron. Okay, let's keep. Now, I wanted to get that precept. Let's keep going in verse 7. In which the promise made is that we will become or will be a kingdom of priests according to the order of Melchizedek. According to the order of Melchizedek, which you have to have faith, in which the high priesthood, as it was in the beginning. Okay, we just talked about that. Adam, the first one, baptizing for the remission of sins at that time, okay, shall be restored in the later days. And this is what I've been saying. It's restoring to us in the later days. We're establishing it at this time, brothers and sisters. Same thing that happened during the time of Nephi, same thing's going on here. There's nothing new underneath the sun. Let's keep going. Verse 8. And now, brethren, behold, I, Nephi, being the one upon whom Christ appointed the presidency of the high priesthood among his church here in the land of our inheritance, I call you to the general assembly to inquire you to keep his commandments. To do what? To keep his commandments. Baptism. Laying on of hands, eternal judgment, the resurrection. Okay, let's keep reading. And to dignify ourselves before his eyes as a holy people and worthy of his grace, and worthy of his grace, and worthy of his grace, his great, his power, his anointing. Let's keep going. So let us stand up to erect the society and cities that Jesus Christ, or Yeshua Christ, has presented to us, so that we may enter into his rest. This is all, see, and this is what we're headed to, brothers and sisters. If we maintain this level, we're baptizing right now. We're laying on of hands. We're talking about eternal judgment. We're staying focused in the holy priesthood. We will rest in him, brothers and sisters, if we maintain this road. But the devil's going to set up traps. And I'm going to show you in these couple of verses how the devil's going to come. Now let's go to verse 10. Remember, however, that all good feelings come from God. Come from who? Come from God. We're going to work on our discernment right now, brothers and sisters. All good feelings come from God. All good feelings. All right? And that evil settlements proceed from the devil. And what? And evil settlements process from the devil. Let's go into those evil settlements. Let's go into them real quick. So you can know. So you can discern. Let's go to John. John 10 and 10. John 10 and 10. John 10 and 10. And it reads, "The thief cometh not, but for to steal. So this is how he attacks. And the number one thing he does is to steal your peace. You'll wake up one day and just, you know, having joy in your heart. Then all of a sudden a thought comes and he steals your peace. It's up to you to discern that. Let's keep going. To kill, he wants to kill you. He wants to murder you and to destroy. And then he wants to destroy your life. He wants to destroy your walk. These are the three settlements that proceed from the evil one. He wants to steal your peace, steal anything from you. Okay? Not just your peace. He wants to kill and he wants to destroy you. All right? I'm giving you guys some knowledge. Let's keep going. And that evil settlements proceed from the devil, and that it will not be possible to erect such a united order. So we have to discern as becoming leaders and high priests of the Most High, the feelings of the Most High and the evil settlements of the devil. Because if we leave, because if we let these evil settlements proceed from the devil, it will be impossible to unite this order of the holy priesthood. We got to stay ahead of the devil. Let's keep going. The likeness of the city of Enoch. Okay, and that's what our goal is, to have that likeness of the city of Enoch. All of them were united. Okay. It says, among the Nephites, if in any way do unbalance to the divine nature that is in you. Okay? Allowing that the bad feelings derived from the evil penetrate into your hearts. Do what? Penetrate into your hearts. I'm gonna read that again. This is what we don't want to have happen. Allowing that the bad feelings derived from the evil penetrate into our hearts. Into where? Into our hearts. Okay? Let me give an example how he does it. Let's go to Galatians. Galatians 5. Galatians 5 and 26. Galatians 5 and 26. We got to stay ahead of the devil, because he don't want this. He don't want us to unite at all. Galatians. If you had to cut off people, cut them off. Galatians. Galatians 5 and 26, and it reads, "Let us not be desirous of vainglory, Let us what? Let us not be desirous of vainglory, provoking one another. Doing what? Provoking one another. We can't provoke one another. Envying one another. Being jealous of one another. This is all the devil needs, is an inch. And this united order will be destroyed, brothers and sisters. Okay? Now let's keep going. Verse 11. Because the devil is an enemy of God, and his gifts distill feelings that poison the good heart. That what? That poison the good heart. That what? That poison the good heart. And this is what the devil's attacking. The heart. Okay? Or the mind. Whichever you want to call it. Let's get an example. Let's go to Acts chapter 5. Acts chapter 5. Well, in and out of the Bible. Acts chapter 5. Acts chapter 5. And verse 3. And this is Ananias and his wife Sapphira. Okay? It says, but Peter said, Ananias, why has Satan filled thy heart? Why has Satan filled thy heart? And our elder, he did a lesson the other day about showing people that the heart is a portal. Okay? You could bring good feelings or you could bring evil feelings into your heart. And Satan, yeah, I'm showing you how Satan gets into your heart. Because this is this chapter in Acts chapter 5, they held back the property from the disciples when they said they were already gonna do it. And Satan did what? Verse 3. But Peter said, Ananias, why has Satan filled thy heart to lie to the Holy Spirit? That's what he attacks, brothers and sisters. He'll persuade you at the last second. He comes to steal. He'll put envy in your heart. He'll put murder in your heart. Murder your brother. This is his job, brothers and sisters. This is what he's in. He's going to try to destroy this holy priesthood, brothers and sisters, by coming into your mind and giving you thoughts that are not of the Most High God, feelings that are not of the Most High God. You got to pay attention. Let's keep going. Verse 11, because the devil is an enemy of God, and his gifts distill feelings that poison the good heart. It says, waging constant struggles between the gifts of life, okay, that come from the Most High, with those who produce death. Verse 12, yea, verily, verily, I say unto you, that every feeling that persuades men to do good among their brethren, okay, every feeling that if you want to do good to your brethren, right, and implies them to love, okay, loving your brethren, it proceeded from the hand of God, giving you discernment. If you seeing brothers loving one another, helping one another, okay, laboring with one another, that's love. That's a good feeling from God. Let's read verse 13. But behold, every settlement which is opposed to these, which is what? Which is opposed to these, not helping your brethren, not loving them, though seems to be beneficial, if it does not meet the needs of its fellow man in love, then it proceedeth from the evil. If there's no love there between brethren, this is when Yeshua said, you shall judge them by their fruits. You got to love your fellow brethren. This is how you're going to discern. Okay? You go to a group, you go to a Hebrew Israelite group out there, and you discerning from good and evil, how they operating. Pay attention, brothers and sisters. You're going to see if it derives from the evil one or derives from the holy one. Let's keep going. Verse 14, therefore, be careful not to fall into the traps of the devil and be entangled in his fishing net. For the sentiments derived from his gifts tend to be similar to divine feelings. You got to be very careful. Because why? Because it's going to trick your mind. It's going to play mind games with you. You're going to think that it's from God, but it's actually not, brothers and sisters. Remember, let me just get a precept real quick. Let's go to Isaiah 14 and 14. In every way possible, Isaiah 14 and 14. Let's get it. If I can find it, let's get it. Isaiah 14 and 14. And it reads, I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. I will be like the Most High. I will be like the Most High. So let me read that one more time in the Sealed Book of Mormon. This is 14. For the sentiments derived from the gifts tend to be similar. Tend to be what? Similar. See, the devil wants to be like God. So he's going to have similar ways. Okay? It's almost going to be... This is why when Christians go to the Christian church, they can't discern from evil from good. They think it's good. Oh, these people are, you know, they're walking holy, you know. No. You got to really discern what's going on. All right? It says, to divine feelings. It says, while deceiving the earthly man, the carnal man, with such persuasions, to the point of men quantifying the bad as good and the good with bad. Okay, see, discernment. Quantifying the bad as good and the good with bad. Okay, you really got to discern, brothers and sisters. Let's get a precept, because this is talked about in the book of Isaiah. You got to watch out. Let's go to Isaiah chapter 5. Isaiah chapter 5. Isaiah chapter 5, and we're going to read 20 and 21. And it reads, woe unto them that call evil good and good evil, that put darkness for light. That what? That put darkness for light. And light for darkness, that put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. Woe unto them. What does woe mean? Woe means war, right? Or destruction. Woe unto them that are wise in their own eyes and prudent in their own sight. We really got to discern, brothers and sisters, because we can't see good and put it for evil and put evil. You know what I'm saying? We can't do that, brothers and sisters. We got to really discern. This is some knowledge right here. Let's go to Proverbs real quick. Go to Proverbs 17:15. Proverbs 17:15. And it reads, he that justify the wicked, he that justify the wicked, and he condemneth the just, even they both are an abomination to the Lord. Come on out of here. Even both are an abomination to the Lord. Discernment, brothers and sisters. This devil is slick, and he's trying to cause confusion in your own mind. Pray and fast. Okay? Pray and fast. Let's keep going. Verse 15. But behold, Jesus Christ, or Yeshua Christ, did not leave us completely forsaken when he departed. Okay? See, Yeshua, when the disciples were walking around, they had Yeshua with them. But now since Yeshua left, okay, went back to the Father, okay, but he's not just sitting up there just, you know, with glue on his butt. But he sent the Holy Spirit now with us. Okay? So we got to operate in the Holy Spirit. Keep seeking the Holy Spirit. It says, but behold, Yeshua Christ did not leave us completely forsaken when he departed, but sent us the Holy Spirit. But what? But sent us the Holy Spirit, who is given to us by the gifts of the Holy Spirit after baptism. After what? After baptism. This is why you're getting baptized, brothers and sisters. Because the Most High wants to give you his Holy Spirit so you can discern good and evil. Let's keep going. It says, after baptism, by the laying on of the hands of those who oppress the due authority, so that we may distinguish good from evil. After you baptize, okay, I've done this before. We baptized and we laid on hands. This is what we do, so they can distinguish good from evil, right? It says, the authority so that we may distinguish good and from evil and have a perfect discernment to separate the darkness. To what? To separate the darkness from the light that fills our hearts. So now you wonder why brothers out there didn't want you to get baptized. So you wouldn't get laid on of hands by the anointed men of God, and you wouldn't receive the baptism to knowing good from evil. Okay? It says, and thus chose to follow the path of clarity through the teachings of his gospel. Okay? Verse 16. Therefore, I beseech you, brethren and friends, that together with us remain gathered in the church of Christ as one body, and diligently seeking to distinguish between the darkness of the devil and the light of Christ in his way of filling and putting aside all that is detrimental to their way of life. Verse 17, this therefore is the secret that God protected and sealed to the knowledge knowledge of the present age. And it says to be revealed only in the fullness of time. See, it's being revealed. It's being unsealed right now. Therefore, when he created the first man and the first woman, God endowed them with the fullness of his being, and there was no evil feelings in their hearts. They couldn't distinguish the evil. All they had was good. Okay, there was nothing evil in their hearts. But because of their fall, their descendants inherit sin and death. So now we got those feelings, all right? And the weakness of the soul and the bondage of the spirit in themselves. Verse 18, this caused men to be enslaved by the oppressing settlements created by the arch enemy of our God. So we were being trained already since we were born, okay, by the evil settlements of the evil one. We know. We was in the world. We know all every evil. We was in the gangs. We was doing drugs. We was being whoremongers. We know all that stuff. So now, when we meet God, now we're receiving the good feelings in our hearts. And now we got both the knowledge of good and evil. You hearing me? Let's keep reading. And unless we submit to living under the guidance of the heavenly laws, unless we do that by mutual agreement of the laws of his gospel, okay, we shall never be wholly free from corruption and lust that continually tax our hearts through a whirlwind of feelings and a subtle of thoughts. Okay, if we don't follow his laws, okay, we'll never be able to separate good from evil. That's why you see Christians out there. They keep on backsliding. They can never have. They keep. They're like a wave. they keep on just they're double minded. Okay, it says, which continually derive us from the path we must follow. I'm gonna read that again. Stupor of thoughts. Okay, we gotta control our thoughts, brothers and sisters, which continually drive us from the path we must follow. Okay, let's go to a precept real quick on our thoughts. Okay, because this devil, he's constantly coming at our mind. This is 2 Corinthians 10 and 5. Casting down imagination and every thought and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing unto captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. So now, since you got baptized, got laid hands on, now you got the Holy Spirit to discern good from evil. And you, all your life, you've been walking in evil until you came to Christ. And that was for a purpose, so you can discern good from evil. So now, you're feeling the Holy Spirit. You're walking in the Holy Spirit for the first time. And now, discern, brothers and sisters, from the evil one and from the Most High. Okay, let's keep going. Because Adam and Eve didn't have this they didn't know good and evil. Yeah, they just knew good. So we have this opportunity to overcome the evil one. Verse 19, but with the Holy Spirit of God, through his gifts, Zion will overflow with peace and meekness among the citizens. This is what's going to happen. For the good feelings, as if it were a voice in our ears, as if it what were a voice in our ears. Remember that. Will have to indicate us the way forward. Amen. That's the Holy Spirit. It says, as if it were a voice in our ears. Let's get some scriptures real quick. Let's get two scriptures. Let's go to Isaiah 30 and 31. Isaiah 30 and 31. Sorry if this lesson is a little longer than usual, but I really want you guys to get this. Isaiah 30 and 31, or 21, excuse me. Isaiah 30 and 21, and it reads, and thy ears shall hear a word behind thee. And what? And thy ears shall hear a word behind. This is the Holy Spirit saying, this is the way, walk ye in it. Saying, this is the way, walk ye in it. This is like how Alder Ayi always says, when you're driving and you go over that speed limit, you're going to hear a voice in your ear saying, slow down. It's the same way. This is what the scripture is saying. Isaiah 30 and 21, and it says, and thy ear shall hear a word behind thee, saying, this is the way, walk ye in it. When ye turn to the right hand, and when ye turn to the left hand, or to the left. Pay attention to that voice, brothers and sisters. Let's go to Proverbs 3 and 6 real quick. Proverbs 3 and 6. Proverbs 3 and 6. And it says, in all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path. So when you hear those voices, this is the way. This is the way. Acknowledge him. Say, Most High, everything you do, say, thank you, Most High. Thank you, Most High. And he shall direct your path, brothers and sisters. He's not a man that he should lie. Right? He's bound by his word, brothers and sisters. Let's keep going. These were the words of my father, Nephi, in remembrance of the teaching of Christ. When the 12 gathered all the Nephites from among the Jacobites, Josephites, and Zebronites for the purpose of building among them the city of Zion and the new Jerusalem, as prophesied by the prophets of the past, being that more than 1,000 souls were baptized. Being what? Being more than 1,000 souls being baptized. Come up on out of here. What's going on right now? Let's come on. Let's keep reading. In that occasion, because of the words of my Father. Brothers and sisters, I want to give all glory, honor, and praise to the Most High God, Ahayah, in the mighty name of Yeshua, for this word in due time. Stay blessed, brothers and sisters, and keep seeking the Most High. Pray, fast, and watch. Love, long-suffering, meek, patient, gentleness, the fruits of the Spirit will lead you. Shalom.